Good morning and welcome back everyone who was just there for the introduction session given by Joke and Arfan. And welcome for those of you who are just logging in. So my name is Esther Warnert. I'm assistant professor here at the Department of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine at the Erasmus Medical Center, also a board member of VENA. And I'm very, very pleased to moderate the first half hour of the panel discussions. So we have about an hour of lively debate ahead of us, where we're going to discuss the challenges, but also the possible solutions to reach gender equality for a sustainable tomorrow. So I'm joined here in this first half hour by a panel of great speakers, researchers, nurse practitioners. So I'm going to, without further ado, ask all of them to briefly introduce themselves before we kick off. So very firstly, to my right, we have Daphne van der Helden.
Good morning, I'm Daphne van Helden. I'm a PhD candidate at Erasmus University. In my PhD research, I study diversity in academic careers, and I explore how both academics and universities play a role in creating sustainable careers.
Nice, thank you. And next to Daphne, we have Dr. Gennady Rushupkin.
Hi everyone. So yes, I'm Gennady Rushupkin. I'm assistant professor at the Department of Epidemiology and also at the Department of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine. So in my group, we are working on developing new artificial intelligence methods to analyze epidemiological data and medical imaging to improve healthcare and also understand human biology better.
And then on my very left, we have Dr. Richard van Valen.
Good morning all. I'm Richard van Valen. I'm a nurse practitioner and a researcher on the Department of Cardiothoracic Surgery. And one of my missions in life is to make sure that nurses and other allied health professionals get a voice in national and international scientific communities.
All right, thank you. And then next to Richard, we have Corine van der Zande.
Good morning. I'm working for HR and since 2009 at Erasmus MC. I'm an advisor, leadership and talent development. I coordinate the female career development program and I talk with a lot of women, but also men who want to make a career in science.
Yeah, and I think Corine, to start off with you, also with your experience here at the medical center, what do you really see as a main challenge of gender equality that we're facing these days?
Before I answer the question, what is the main challenge, I would like to add something, because I know that in 2011, the percentage of female professors was 11%. Now, more than 10 years later, it was 13%. 2011 was 13%. Now, more than 10 years later, it's 22.5%. So that's 1% per year. If we don't change something now, we will never change. It will take until 2050 before we have equal men, women in science. So I think it's very important to do things. And what are the main things we can do? I think we have so many biases, implicit biases. And I think it's very important to look a step further and to do introspection, every one of us, and to make sure that we create diverse teams, that we use the added value of other cultures, the other gender, in all kind of groups. And we need role models, definitely, for that. Yeah.
Well, so I really like to chime in that role model piece, because I know, Richard, in your research, so you've previously highlighted that role models is so important to make sure that you have that diverse group of, co-workers, people on the floor. So can you elaborate a little bit on that, how you see that? So that piece of role models that Corine is highlighting too.
Yes. Well, what I was referring to is the fact that when you come to an average clinical ward, you will see a lot of very young nurses till about the age of 28, 30. You'll see a couple of male nurses, and then you have a large blind spot for nurses between something like 30 to 45. And everybody will say, well, yeah, they got children. But that is so importantly not true, because having a child doesn't prevent you from working, even as a nurse. And I understand it's more difficult to work days, evenings and night than it is to work only during the day, but it is possible to have a career and have a family, and not only for the female nurses, but also for the male nurses. And that's the thing I'm really interested in is, why do we lose all those male nurses? I just told Corina when I went to the nursing school, we had 110 students in total, 10 were male, and at the moment, three of the males are still working within a clinical setting, and the rest is all been faded away. So when it comes to things like that, we need role models, people who say, well, it is possible to have a successful career, to have fun in your job, and be able to run your family together with your spouse or whoever can help you. And when we can get that as a role model into the clinic, then we will see more nurses staying longer. If I may take another minute, another important thing is the autonomy. Nobody is completely autonomous within large organizations, but having something to say about your schedules, having something to say about the amount of schooling you need to feel up to the job is very important. So we need role models and we need ways to find how not only nurses, but physical therapists, and I think even scientists can say, if I want to do this, I need a healthy environment and this is what I need.
Yeah. But and what I find interesting there is that you also mentioned, so you see in the education, you see 10 male students versus 100 female students.
Yeah.
And I guess quite often in your case, Corine, you already see maybe a bit more 50-50 at the lower ranks. Mm-hmm. Can you comment a little bit on that? Like how do you see that sort of progressing or not progressing? Because I guess, you know, having role models is an example, but by now, in academia, aren't there quite a lot of female role models already?
Mm-hmm. Yes, but I think we do need more. And what is also the case, I prefer to talk about feminine qualities and masculine qualities or styles. Mm-hmm. And what you see that the masculine styles are very much rewarded and that they are very influential on the culture we have. So I think it's also a matter of what do we reward in our organization? How do we see the added value of, the feminine styles or the masculine styles when we talk about nursing?
Yeah.
So it's, I think, I strongly believe that we have to look at things in different perspectives and we use the different people to look at the different perspectives.
Yeah, and I guess what makes that really, really valuable is having those different perspectives, but really also bring the work forward,
mm-hmm.
probably, right? So if you see on the work floor, perhaps,
yeah.
something that, I don't know, when I look at Daphne in your research, is that something that you have found when you look at your research, you're looking at mining, making the gender gap smaller. Is that something that comes out of your research as well, that having a diverse, equal men, equal women, diversity within your working group, does that improve quality? Does that lead to more stimulating environments?
Well, I do not study exactly the effects on performance or so I do not exactly know about that part, but in my study, I explored that many gender biases exist in academia that challenge to create a sustainable career.
Can you elaborate a bit more on that? Those biases that you're saying? So can you give an example of some of those biases?
Yeah, so maybe it's first good to mention that these barriers manifest itself across several levels. So at the individual level, but also at the organizational level, but also in society. For instance, think about gender stereotypes. What I want to highlight is that these barriers may appear to be individual issues, but they are tied to work structures and to organizational norms and assumptions about, for instance, I study academic career, so these norms and assumptions about the ideal scientist or the ideal career track, that really impacts how academics evaluate or reflect on their own career path. And in particular, women experience challenging things and not a very supportive environment in dealing with this ideal images of a career track or the ideal scientist.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Did anyone look at differences between the, for example, social studies, economic studies, history, medical professions, on how the differences between masculine and female qualities developed in those different fields? Because I can imagine that in the social academy, it's less of a thing than it is with us.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I fully agree that there are some subtle but also not so subtle differences between academic fields, but in general they have in common that we're dealing with a hierarchy within and outside academia, and that there is an individualistic and competitive structure. So I agree that there are some subtle differences, for instance, in the economic or the business management field, where they're also working with tenure tracks. So that's a different system than, for instance, in this organization. But in general, women, but also men, are dealing or challenging, well, they experience, yes, difficulties with the competitive and individualistic culture. So they share a lot of things. It's not that different, but of course there are subtle differences to notice.
Yeah, Kennedy, go ahead.
Yes, if I think that Daphne mentioned a really good point. So if I can bring that difficulties, because all these role models, of course, that's really important. But I think I feel that sometimes in academia, especially like even in academic social media, you know, like Twitter and other discussion, people LinkedIn, so people tend to like just publish something what they celebrate in some success stories, like grants, publications, new appointment, etc. And then it becomes like this Instagram life. You know, you see just that everything is going well for everyone. And then you, as in academia, you think, okay, that I'm doing something wrong. And that's because actual academic life, you have a lot of actually failures. So you just have rejection of the grants, rejection of the papers, maybe some other issues. And I think that's also additional to successful role models. That's important to bring also this awareness that actually it's quite difficult anyway for everyone, even for successful people. Then it's not only your struggles, it's struggles for everyone.
But and would you argue that that means that it's really difficult to sort of gauge what is success really? Because indeed, if you look at Instagram, you only see success, right? So you think, oh, everybody only publishes the papers all the time. And I know that, you know, you have that CV of failures, I think somebody publishes every year, which is something really nice to have, right? But I think, Corinne, you alluded to this earlier. You say, well, how do we define quality? So then if, you know, it is still important, I guess, to have all those papers and to have all those grants. So how do you see that within the Erasmus MC, for instance? Like, how do people deal with that? Are they truly counting all their successes or?
Well, that's what we stimulate. So I really would like that we are going to stimulate more teamwork, more taking care for each other, more stimulating others to be able to flourish, to start their career. So not only counting for your success, but the success for the team. I think that's very important. Yeah. And I'm happy with the new development, recognition and rewarding. But it's not only in science, it's also in, if you walk through the hall here at Erasmus MC, you see the people who won the prizes, which is incredible, and I have a deep respect for them. But it would also be beautiful if we would have some photographs of nurses who have done a lot of, special things every day in daily life. That is also a role model. So let's reward also a lot of other things in our organization.
Yeah, and I think that's something really nice as well. At research, you also mentioned, I think, to me earlier, is that recognition and rewarding is so important to also make sure that you want to progress and you want to stay and you enjoy your work. Is that something you want to elaborate on a little bit as well?
Well, I can tell you that the Erasmus MC has been not the quickest hospital in the Netherlands or in the world to work towards it. But I'm very happy to see that in this hospital, at the moment, there is a VAR, a nursing advice board, who can advise, Professor Van der Boe, for example. And that is one of those things that are very important, that you see that you are listened to and that you can partake in a body of knowledge that is able to give advice to a higher level. So that is a very important thing. And together with that, what you see in different other hospitals is a chief nursing officer. That's also something you could call like a role model, somebody who has earned her or his spores and now is the talking point for everybody in the hospital when it comes to nursing, who is able to give advice to young nurses who don't know what next career step they can take. Something like what you tell, you just talk to people, you let them tell their story, and then you together see what the options are. But that same chief nursing officer also can advise if there are nursing shortages and some steps need to be taken. But that is, in a lot of the time, that is the problem. And we've seen it here in our own intensive care unit with a lot of sick intensive care nurses, but also high demands on the beds. And that gives an enormous amount of struggle between management, medical staff, and nursing staff. And you see that if we can work together on those difficult areas, then you will have role models, then you'll have a nurse who will feel that she or he is heard, and then you will have happier nurses. And that is the most important thing.
Certainly.
Yes, Esther, there is a question in the chat. Surely we should speak about equity rather than equality. So I'm very curious what the panelists have to say about this.
Ooh, this is a good question.
Is everyone familiar with the definitions of equity and equality? I don't know if the speakers are familiar with this topic. Because
to be quite honest, it just reminds me of something from the financial world.
To be honest, I looked it up as well, and it says that equality means that each individual or group of people is given the same resources or opportunities, whereas equity recognizes that each person has different circumstances and allocate the exact resources and opportunities needed to reach an equal outcome.
Cool. So this would really be focused on giving everybody the same room to develop? Is this what we're highlighting towards?
I think so. Just to recognize that there is a difference between both and that not everyone has the same circumstances and opportunities.
Yeah, certainly. And Kennedy, you wanted to mention something there.
Yeah, I was just thinking, just to make it more clear. So I think that's, from the scientific perspective, I think that's... given also the diversity based on the gender or other type of diversity, I think that's science is part of the creativity. So that's to be successful in science, it's actually teamwork and to bring different perspective and like angle of the view, different background. And I think that's actually in the science, this, even if you have a different, baseline, there should be also, you should get the opportunity to, to develop your skills, because everyone has a different maybe opportunity, like a baseline, but then you should be able in scientific community should be supported, and because eventually you never know which point of view can bring you successful like discovery and research outcome. So I think that's also should be supported. Yes. Yeah. So.
And maybe then an interesting follow-up question on that. So that support, where is that needed? I guess everywhere, but is that support needed from within the group, from sort of from your peers, but also from the top down? Like, should we enforce that somehow? Do you have thoughts on how to reach that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that's also part of the topic what about the career path in general in academia, because it's quite hierarchical and basically there's no really middle layer. Like if you want to be successful in academia, you either on the path from like PG student to the professorship, or just middle layers really like considered as a temporal. But that's actually again, so if someone has certain skills to do certain research, but don't want to become actually maybe professor, that should be also supported. Yeah. So, and that's the same. So in the group level, if you can do like you don't like write papers, but you like to do analysis. So why not? And you can be really good in like writing, you know, analysis code and do analytical research. So, but you don't want to manage grant application, let's say. So that also should be supported in a way that otherwise you can lose really maybe a brilliant person who is really good with a certain type of the knowledge and the skills. But just because in academic past, that's really considered something temporal, basically. So that should be changed in some way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And maybe Corine, to pass that question to you a little, mm-hmm. is that something you see there is also a drive towards in the Erasmus, where we're working maybe a little bit more, little bit less towards individuals, but a little bit more to teamwork? You alluded to that earlier as well. Mm-hmm. Like how does that really then come to play in real life?
Well, what Kennedy says, I think is really true, that you have to ask every individual, what do you need to develop yourself, to flourish, and to create the circumstances. So I think that if every individual gets the chance to do that, and of course, there must be things to say, well, we have to work together and there's a teamwork. So how do we work together as a team is also a very important question. But that there is more focus on the individuals, the employees. What do you need?
And I guess that would really link in well as well in your end, Richard, to make sure that if the individual there is really hurt, that really makes sure that you can...
Yeah.
Retain people longer.
Yes,
at least.
Yeah. I do so that you feel that you're recognized, that you're important, that your work is important. Whatever you do, but it's important for the organization. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Just to add on this, I think that's part of what Daphne described with her research. So actually, sometimes you can ask actually the people what they have, kind of issues they have. But also, let's say, not only asking successful, for instance, like role models, how they end up in this position, but maybe also ask people who quit from academia what was the reasons. So mm-hmm. if you want to change something, you need to also see why people like live in academia or like nursing or hospital, etc. So that's can also give you a different perspective, because if you look only on successful part of the story, that maybe you will not find the reasons why some people are leaving.
Yeah. Well, maybe it's important that role model is not defined as somebody who shows only his or her successes, but who shows also the vulnerable periods, the failures, also our role models are just human, and that you can reach that as well.
So maybe going more towards realistic role models.
Realistic role models, yes.
And I was just wondering, because you have a lot of data, I guess, right? So that's what we scientists love. Mm-hmm. Is this something you see in, because you have data and you've interviews about both men and women, mm-hmm. right? Something that is there a different need for that realistic role model? Is that something you've already seen in your research?
Well, to be honest, I think that both men and women, they are searching for and they aiming for a psychological safety climate in their department and in their organization, in which they can become or be their authentic selves. I really like the concept of authentic selves, so that you can be or become and also strive for the career that you want that fits with your ideals and norms. So I guess in that sense, there are not very large differences. Both men and women are dealing with how they can and become their authentic selves in the organization. And of course, there are subtle differences. For instance, that women are having more difficulties in dealing with for instance, male culture at the moment, or with inadequate responses to incidents in the work, in the work structure. Yeah. But in general, they are both, it's a very important factor to keep in mind, psychological safety, because it can stimulate the well-being of employees, but also their authentic careers.
Yeah, yeah. And when you then go, when you mention your that psychological safety, is that easy understanding? Everybody needs to feel happy, but is that also something you see you can help your colleague with, or maybe something that you would have advice for supervisors to help their the people who they manage with?
Yes, it is a concept or a situation that only can create in communication between people, because you can only be yourself. Because if you want to know if you're fit in the idol, you compare yourself with others. So there is an interaction with others. And to be included, you want to include it in a group. So it definitely comes from your team, for your supervisor, from other persons in leadership roles, but definitely also with communication with your colleagues. So the whole organization is, well, it should be a shared responsibility. I should phrase it like that.
I agree with this, but I also think that, well, the whole this event and what also Richard mentioned about this nursing that advisors can put on the top, let's say from bottom to top, I think that's really important for to have an organization this awareness and also the way to communicate. So let's say if you have some issues with or like you feel that extra stress, or you feel that some pressure based on the also like this male structure or other things, or even like, okay, another topic is like even harassment things, so like this, so that should be important, that people should be aware that there is some in the Erasmus industry also like structure where you can come office, let's say, in people, you can come and talk about this. And maybe that's important that if your supervisors or like team members, they can support you, but also important then someone, let's say, outside this kind of conflict of interest also out there who you can talk with. Because I think that it can be that people just sometimes struggle to bring it further.
Yeah. No, very good point. I see that there is actually a really nice question in the chat there,
yeah.
But we have to be careful not to mix up our authentic self with the traditional role models defined in our culture. This is, I guess, a very, very true point, because, well, authentic self, there can be quite a mismatch, I guess, with what our traditional role models state. And maybe, Richard, that's particularly something maybe you will see as well in your...
Yeah, you can find very good examples of that in the field of nursing, but pretty much in every field. And it can be as simple as that. I found a study of 2014 from Canada, of all places, still wondering, are male nurses able to give loving care? And that is such a completely strange concept to me, because everybody who becomes a nurse should be able to give that kind of care in moments, and that if everybody else has a different kind of speciality, that's okay. But what you see is that losing what is in you to fulfill the view of society, to fulfill the view of your manager, doesn't work. That is the way to lose personnel that would be that is very qualified to work with those sick patients. So I think it's very important that everybody can be his or her unique self. And I think losing the stereotype of male professions and female professions is one of the very important ones, but it's so difficult to get rid of. The first time I did an internship, I was 19 years old. I was in a nursing home, and I was the first male nurse there. And people were actually terrified that patients would be terrified to see me coming into the room at night. And there was absolutely no problem. So society has a certain view on roles, and whether it be scientific, whether it be nursing, whether it be career pathways, and that is so rigid that is a big problem and a big challenge for all of us to keep working on in the coming years.
Yeah, and I think that would be a really nice note to sort of thank the four of you that we're going to slowly wrap up this first half of the session. A lot of interesting food for thought here, at least. And I think to end with that note, that it's still really, really hard to get rid of the traditional stereotypes that we see all around us. really does require just a lot of dialogue, probably a lot of discussions, a lot of talking. So with that, I think I would like to thank the four of you very much. I think we have a few moments just to make sure that we're going to wrap up and we have the switch of gears of the people here at the table. And don't hesitate to keep on asking questions in the chat while I think you guys will be swapping. Yep. And I'm looking here at them. So thank you all very much.
Thank you.
So while in the background they're swapping, I think we are really having some interesting discussions here. I also really want to tell all of you in the audience, don't forget that if you have something there in the chat, we can read it. We see it pop up in the screen, but sometimes we also have Alice notifying us that there's something in the chat. And while this is happening, we're slowly moving towards the second half hour. And I see a change in the guard. Without any further ado, again, a very same session as just now. So I'm going to start off with briefly introducing, I'm going to ask all four of the new panel members to briefly introduce themselves. Starting with my far right, we have Professor Dr. Gijs van Soest.
I'm a professor in the Department of Cardiology. I specialize in the development of technologies for imaging the heart and vessels from inside, so on catheters. I'm a physicist by training, but have been working on medical imaging for more than 15 years now.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Next to Gijs, we have Professor Semiha Denktaş.
Yeah, good morning. Thank you for inviting me. Semiha Denktaş, I'm a professor in behavioral sciences at the Erasmus School of Social and Behavioral Sciences at the Erasmus University. And I'm also the Chief Diversity Officer of the Erasmus University.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for being here. And then on my far left, we have Professor Dr. Joke Hendricks.
Yes, good morning, everybody. My name is Joke Hendricks. I'm a vascular surgeon and I'm head of the Department of Surgery and also the chair of Theme Dijkzicht.
Thank you. And next to Joke, we have Professor Dr. Robin Peters.
Thank you very much. Good morning. My name is Robin Peters. I'm the head of the Department of Internal Medicine and also the chair of the Dutch Society for Internal Medicine.
Yeah, thank you. So maybe Semiha, starting with you, in your background, maybe you're the best person to ask us, what do you see as a main action point to really reach gender equality at both the ERA and the Erasmus MC?
Yeah, well, there is no magic bullet. I heard a lot of issues coming up in the panel previous. And I think you have cultural, organizational cultural adjustments that we have to make, but also have to look into the structures that keep on putting barriers for gender equity. And it's not just gender equity. I think if you look at all dimensions of diversity, then we have structural barriers within our organizations that prevent people from getting in equal positions.
Yeah, and what is it? Can you give an example of one of those structural barriers?
Well, if you look at our HR procedures, we are improving. But if you look at the composition of the committees that have to review a resume, then there needs to be a committee that is diverse, because then you can take into account different perspectives. Now we're looking through one type of glasses to the CVs, to the resumes, and we have sort of said, well, this is the golden standard that people have to adhere to, and then we will say, well, he or she is ready to go to the next step in her career. But there is really no golden standard. That's a social construct. Yeah. And that's something we need to look into.
Yeah. Yeah, because I think that's what you're alluding to there. I think a really nice example, I think we discussed that both with Robin and Joke. Maybe Joke, first to you, you mentioned this looking at resumes. And when you have to hire someone, what do you do?
I believe in diverse teams, so I think it's important to look somebody who gives something extra in your team. So it's pretty easy to choose somebody who's the same like you, because it's easy for you to work with. But I think that's not the way to go. So I really believe in diverse teams, and I think we already made a big change. When you look, when I was a resident 20 years ago, I was the only female resident in my whole year, and now already 30% of our surgery staff is a female now. And I see that gives a really different dimension in how we work together and how we discuss together. So that is very important to do.
Yeah. And Robin, how do you do that in your department?
Yeah, well, I fully agree with what Joke says. I also believe in diverse teams. I also think that diversity is much broader than gender, for example. And as an example, over the last 2 years, both within our national society as well as within the department, we really paid particular attention to looking with different glasses to resumes when hiring candidates, for example, because there's so much different qualities that we can use and that we can look at. And I think it's really a matter of changing your mindset to really look at all the different aspects of quality and not only look at resumes, using the standard ways, like, for example, how I was selected 20 years ago.
And is there something, Gijs, because I know you also, you really strive for diversity within your teams as well. Is there something specific then that you perhaps don't look at, or something you really don't want to do anymore that we did for the past 20 years?
Well, I think, I mean, the start of it indeed is to look for basically what complementarity in diversity. So, and what I'm missing for a large part in many of these debates is that we don't really have a good narrative what diversity is good for, what it brings us. So there's often a personal argument that centers on fairness, and there should be access to everyone to what we do in academia, and to a point that's true. But there's also another side. So the diversity actually improves what we do. And I'm a scientist, and I think what we do in science is for a large part problem solving. And diversity in approaches in problem solving actually brings real value that is, well, maybe can even be objectified. And that is something that I think we should develop much more than we currently do. And I think that's also something that I think within Erasmus-MC we can develop much better than we do currently.
Yeah. And Samia, is that something you see as a main challenge, I guess, as well? Or maybe a main spear point for your...
Yeah, well, I think there's excellent research to refer to in other disciplines that have been investigating the value of diversity, and there have been narratives, and I agree, for sometimes it was... the motive was it's a great business plan to have more diversity, but we're not selling products, we're delivering services. So you could also say you can also look at the moral value. But at the end of the day, we're scientists, and we're looking at doing better science. So diversity adds value to that. That has been studied many, many times. And to be honest, we have so many societal challenges. And if we keep on doing the same things as we are doing, then these challenges are not going to be solved. So we need different perspectives. And that's the value of diversity.
Yeah, and then maybe a question to all of you. And I know I've had this discussion with some of you already, but to reach diversity, some people would say maybe we need a quota somewhere. But I know that, you know, it can be a good thing to reach your end goal, but it can also potentially be something that, well, I mean, Robin, maybe you might want to discuss that a little bit.
I know it's a sensitive topic, but yeah. I'm personally very much against it, because I have the feeling that although I know from scientific literature that quota may work on the short term, I feel that we have so much different strengths and so much uniqueness of the people at Erasmus-MC that I'm afraid that using a quota would create, let's say, first and second choices. And if you get a situation where the assumption may be that people are selected because of a quota or because they tick a box, I really feel that there's a disqualification of the people. And so personally, what I try to do is we try to have much more emphasis on looking at all different strengths. So for example, in our applications for internist in training, we have someone in the committee with a diverse background who's really helping us to look at qualities. We have added a personal narrative in which everyone is asked to tell about their personal situation and about their drives. And it really opens stories that people otherwise are not telling because they feel that it's not part of the procedure. And I think that in the end, that is a much more positive approach on using or achieving diversity than just quota.
But it does put a lot of, because in the end, you still have to make sort of a decision, right? And you still have to value those narratives, I guess.
Yeah.
So how do you ensure that you do that well? And I know, Joke, you do that quite a lot as well, mm-hmm. right, in your department. Would you have advice on that? Like, how would you, there's no quota, but you still want to be diverse. How do you take those narratives into account well?
Yeah, I think you have to look at the qualities of the persons and from different perspectives. And that's difficult, but you have to challenge yourself always to look a little bit further than the old standard way. And I personally don't like a quota. For instance, now in the Erasmus MC, in a lot of committees, they ask a women, and I'm asked a lot nowadays, and I don't like that because I feel like an excuus at the moment, because they don't ask me because of my talents, they ask me because I'm a woman, and that's not also right. You have to look at the talents of the persons and pick the right quality for your team.
Yeah,
I think that's important.
Yeah, I know, and then if I look to my right, I know, Kees, you also...
Well, yeah, so there are two aspects to this that I think are counterproductive. And one is, so as soon as the general rule is, as soon as a metric becomes a target, it ceases to be a good metric, because you can play the rules of the game and focus on the game rather than what you're trying to achieve. And the other thing is that there are many things that are not so easily countable, which basically constitute all of diversity that we're interested in. And that's I think it's been said before, but it goes way beyond gender. Yeah. And you need to have a broad palette of individuals, with their own skills and qualities. I think quota in that sense are counterproductive, because you focus on one thing that sticks out and you lose all the other aspects of someone's person.
I do like, though, because this would also be my question. I see there's a question from Annemarie de Graaf, but then how are we going to speed up from that 1% a year? And I think this is alluding to what Corina just mentioned. So this is that we're really only very slowly reaching that number of female professors. Maybe looking
at... Well, I'm not against quota. It's the framing has been very negative. I think It's goal setting, and in behavioral sciences we use a lot of goal setting, and it's scientifically proven that it works. So if you look at the situation of the Erasmus University and also the Erasmus Medical Center, then we have been, if you look at the rankings, national rankings, then we've always been on the bottom of that list. Not until we said, well, we have to aim for 25% in 2025. And that led to me as chief diversity officer to talk to the deans of the faculties and to set some goals. So it's just goal setting, you know, and let's see what is achievable. And when it's about gender, then you look into gender. It's not disqualifying other dimensions of diversity. You're just saying, well, if we compare our university, our medical center with others, then we fall short. And it's not going to change by itself. So you have to set some very clear targets with the deans and work towards these targets. And it's by no means an aim to select women just because they're women. Contrary to that, we know from the literature that women who get into leadership positions have been, for example, publishing 2.5 times more than men. So they are overachievers. So I think we need to look into our criteria and our standards and our procedures and indeed set some goals, because otherwise we'll take forever to get higher percentages. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So you would say the goals would be set to really make that awareness that we have to change the procedures. That would be the way.
Absolutely, but also make a plan, a clear plan, so that there is accountability. Otherwise, we're just going to talk how important it is. But we have to make plans, activate, and then implement policy and monitor. Monitoring is very important, to have these yearly talks with those who are in leadership positions. Yeah. They're accountable.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And is this something, when you mentioned this, so there's a lot of monitoring, but I'm yearly monitoring, yearly discussions. I know both of you are in situations where you have this opportunity, you have the responsibility, I guess, to reach this in your departments. How do you do that? So Robin, how would you do that in your department?
Well, I agree with what Semia is saying, that we need to set goals. I also agree that we need to monitor, and we're doing both. It's just that the point that I was trying to make is that by just focusing on quota, is by focusing on the numbers, you kind of lose the goal and the number becomes the goal. And I think that is not what we should try to achieve. So that is the approach we've been taking. And I think in the end, what I feel is most important is that we need to look at different types of strength. We need to broaden our vision. And by doing that, we also will reduce our, the word unconscious bias. Eh? What I think that is what we should be doing. Yeah. And then you will achieve the goal as well.
Yeah. Yeah, so rather than becoming the purpose, it would just become a side effect from what you're doing. Yeah. And this is a very good point that you are hinting at the unconscious bias that you have. So the typical unconscious bias, of course, comes when you have to hire someone and you look at the resume.
Exactly.
So Joke, what did you tend to see, for instance, when you were in your career reaching the point that you're facing now? Have you encountered a moment where you thought, well, this is not necessarily, maybe I don't tick the traditional CV box, but I think I should advance anyway?
Of course, I didn't tick the CV box myself, so and that worked out very well. But a couple of years ago, for instance, we did interviews for the residency of surgery. And there was somebody with a totally different background than we used to have. Most of the residents have already finished a thesis, a large career before. And this was a person with a migration background. And she performed a lot of work in international organizations for migration problems. And totally different person, totally different CV, and we gave her a wild card to start the residency and to start with the trainee for surgery. And that worked out very well. So that's a good example that you have to think broader than you are used to do. The other way, I want to react a little bit to what Robin said. What I see in my department, that most of the men who want to be a professor, for instance, visit me 2 to 3 times a year to discuss their CV and to show me how good they are. Most women don't come. You have to ask them. Yeah. So I ask all the women who are talented or to come to me, to my office, twice a year and to show how they are doing and what they need to become a professor. And that's different. Most men are looking for you every 2 or 3 months and showing exactly what they are doing. And women are more modest and shy. And so you have to challenge them to take up their talents and do what they do.
Do what they do best. Yeah, and that's, but I always find that a very interesting difference between men and women. That it's, in general, women see 10 tick boxes and think, I have to have those 10 tick boxes before I go and speak to you. So I don't know whether that's something you both, I see both of you have. Okay.
Yeah, well, so I see the same thing happening with young scientists. That's indeed that there is a difference in attitudes where men can be more proactive. And it is also, basically it also provides you a handle where you can act on, like you're saying, Joke. So if there are postdocs who I think are potentially promising researchers and could be independent, basically you have to lay out that path with them, basically make plans for, are there grants you can apply for? Is there, can we look at collaborations? Where can you go internationally? And yeah, sometimes you have to, and I think that again, is looking mostly at the individual quality. Some, and this may be gendered. Some people are a little bit more reluctant to take the initiative there, and some others, are outgoing and basically put their qualities and CV up front. And I think so. One thing that I think is relevant in this context also is that in science we are very preoccupied with the word excellence. That's our main thing that we select for and that we strive for. And I think it can be a very intimidating word for some people. Some people see and this again may be something that women are more sensitive to than some men. Excellence puts the bar very high, and people compare themselves to that bar and may decide not to jump. And that is. That is actually something that can hold people back, even so you won't even see their resume. Yeah. And that is a dynamic that I'm trying to intervene in early, so that people actually do give themselves a position to get on the ladder.
So that's interesting, because I guess that does make, you know, Joke, you mentioned this, and then now you say this as well. It is you stimulating the people in your departments, in your research groups to apply. But is this then also something... Samia, maybe you have some advice. So of course, top down, this is very important, but also maybe bottom up, is there something we can do ourselves?
Yeah, I think I see a lot of proactive women, but in maybe sometimes in different tasks. And I think recognition and reward can be very helpful when we work towards team science. What I see is, when we need organizational citizenship, it's a lot of women who will say, well, I'm willing to help out. And what I see is when there is an individual career perspective, then I see my male postdocs or PhDs, et cetera, and go for it. So it's what I see is that both women and men want their careers, but the women seem to be more modest, and there seems to be something that had happened during how women are socialized. Well, that really goes back many, many years in our lives. But what is important that with recognition and reward and with team science, and everyone can be valued, and we don't need to focus so much on individual results and individual excellence. I think that's something that goes wrong. And still, we need good scientists, both in applied sciences and fundamental science. So we shouldn't get rid of publishing or whatever.
Yeah. No, I think that's an important point. So it is a danger. It's basically, it feels like you might be lowering ambitions, or
I think
that is not true. I think you're considering a bigger picture.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
And this individual model of the it's been called the superhero scientist is very dominant in science, particularly in life sciences
and basically in every discipline. I think we need to go towards team science and make sure that we have diverse teams, and then we I think together we can do so much more than individual.
But I guess inherently with team science you might have the problem, though, that, you know, how do you match team science with the hierarchical hierarch, hierarchy that is there in academia and the...
I have a strong opinion. So hierarchy is not a fact. That's not a law of nature.
No.
That's something that we created.
Yeah.
That is a changeable circumstance. But it's a massive cultural change. Yeah. Just like team science is the releasing or constructing other social forms and norms than hierarchy. Mm-hmm. That is something that requires active effort.
Yeah.
Also, I mean, the dominance of the competitive model that we have. Leads to a lot of, and this is anecdotal, and I'm sure that Samir, you have data on this. Particularly women checking out, say, "I have better things to do with my life than writing rejected grants," and so that is also again a filter where you never get to see the resume of these people because they decide early on after their PhD, like, "Well, thank you, this was interesting, and now I'm going to do some real work."
Yeah, interesting. So I see hand waves, but I can't read. The full, you wanted to have a question from there, Alice?
Yes, there are several questions in the chat. And one of them is, if you have the goal and the monitoring, why is the progress so slow? And I'm really curious to what the panelists have to say about this question.
So that's about, so we have the goal, more or less aiming to reach the 25% of 25. Yeah. We have the monitoring. Interesting question. Why is progress so slow?
Well, in 2017, we had about, I think, almost 14% female professors at the Erasmus University. And by the end of 2020, when we implemented a lot of policy, new policy, and changed some HR procedures, and did some goal setting with the deans, we had 25% female professors. So now the target is higher. So it is doable, but we have to be very, very active on, in my opinion, on goal setting, making plans, making policy, implementing and monitoring. It's an iterative process, it's a social construct, and we have to keep on talking to people, but it's just talking is not enough. There needs to be action. Yeah. And then it's doable.
Yeah. You had another one?
Yes, there's another question in the chat. Doesn't the fact that you only see overachieving women imply that the not overachieving women have barriers that prevent you from seeing them?
Oh, yeah. So this is a good question. And maybe one to ask Yoko. So she's saying it's already difficult to see women approach you themselves, but then the ones that do are probably the ones that are already overachieving, having the 2.5 times more publications than men. Doesn't that in itself imply we still need to change something? And I wonder whether that's still something you see in your department then as well, if you say, well, I still have to drag the women to my office, really.
Yeah, but I don't think in my department the women are overachieving because I think that's the culture in your department, who you reward and who are your supporting. And I don't ask my women or my men to overachieve. I want them to use their talents and I want them to be good surgeons and I want them to be good researchers or educationers or whatever. In a normal working time. So I think that, I hope, maybe when you ask them, they will say, oh, she's very hard, but I hope that's the culture within my department.
So what you're saying, you are really striving to generate the culture that makes sure that you have everybody approach you in the end. Focusing on talent.
And teamwork.
Yeah.
Because everything has to be in balance.
Yeah, yeah. And then the final question.
Yes, it's a bit of a long one.
We can read it ourselves.
Yeah, right. It is in response to the question, the statement that Robin made earlier. If the problem is with the numbers, that the numbers become the goal, don't you say that there are not enough women that meet requirements? So, in other words, that there are more men than women that qualify. she's actually not sure if that's actually true. She doesn't want to be the criticaster all the time. But yeah, I'm really wondering, do you have a reply on that?
Yeah, so let's first, maybe I think it's important that I'm very much in favor of diversity. And I really want to emphasize that we should look at diversity in many, many, many different aspects. So men versus women is one, but cultural background is another one. And there are so many other factors that we can look at. And I think that in the past, maybe we've been too narrow in the way we appreciate talent. And that has to do with one side, how people judge resumes. The other side is how people sell themselves or how they approach. And I think that is a cultural trend. So that is, at least it's what I'm trying to change within my department and within the national society. And I think in the end, that is much more efficient. I'm definitely not saying that there are not enough qualified women. Maybe the situation has been so that we've not been looking with the right glasses at very talented women because we were judging them with a male, from a male perspective. I'm not saying that that's the case anymore, at least within my department. We have, the department is built up of 10 different sections, and we have 5 female section heads and we have 5 male section heads. So we monitor it all the time. But I think in the end, it's about diversity. It's about the strength of the team and the strength of the group. And there are, and we, in that way, many people bring different, different talents to the team. And I think that is most important. And if we focus too much on one thing, we may lose focus of the goal.
Right. Yeah. So then, and to wrap that up, what you're saying really is that on your end, with, for instance, the 5 and 5, you've really already reached sort of a quota number, but not by putting that quota there. Really just by looking at, we want the diversity and we want the talent that we need to run our sections.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I think that is particularly, I think the biggest challenge there is with is maybe even with cultural diversity. And I think there we really need to train ourselves to look at talent in different ways. And I think we need to make steps. And for example, what I mentioned is what we've done in the application process, that we now have a diverse person, we register everything, we've added the personal narrative. I think those are tools to also for us to learn to look at talent in multiple ways.
Yeah. So with that, I'm also looking at the time. I think we're already sort of over time.
Yes, we are.
So what I would like to do then is, first of all, of course, thank all the organizers today. So that's I don't have the full list, so maybe I shouldn't even try because I'm sure I'm going to miss them. But I would like to thank all of you on the other side of the camera for your attention, for your interesting questions as well in our chat. I would like to thank once again all of our panel members for your time and great discussions. And what I also think that we've, one of the most important messages here is that I really like your saying, there's no magic bullets, but we do really need to make sure that we keep that conversation going, that we really create awareness that diversity is the way forward. And with that, I hope there is a very, very nice day ahead that will help us all to make sure that we can do both those bottom-up and top-down interventions. There's great workshops ahead, so I wish you a lot of fun as well today with International Women's Day 2022.